In the previous video, we learned how to populate electrons into our energy level diagrams and how to convert that into electron configurations. In this video, we're going to focus in on how to use the periodic table to guide us into the electron configuration for larger atoms. So let's say, for example, that we are interested in determining the electron configuration of something bigger like bromine. Okay, bromine has 35 electrons, and it would be a task to have to go through the process that we just went through to write out the energy diagram and then populate electrons. So there's a shorter way to do this, okay? And the periodic table is your guide. So the idea here is that the periodic table is grouped together by subshells, okay? So everything over on this side is an S subshell. And notice in the S subshell, we have two columns. There's two columns in the S block that corresponds to the two electrons that the S subshell has a capacity for. Okay? In this position here, right? So from boron all the way over to neon, this is our P block. There are six columns in our P block corresponding to the 10 electron capacity for a P subshell. Okay? Our D block falls in the middle. So there, these 10 columns in the middle here are our D block, and the F block is down here. So the F block corresponds to these 14 columns. Okay, and what's important to recognize about the F block here is that it doesn't actually exist below the rest of the elements. Okay, so it actually exists in this space right here where we just kind of leave an open block. And the reason is that it's put below is so that it makes the periodic table more compact. But in reality, as you're populating electrons into your electron configuration, once you get to barium, you now have to drop down to the lanthanides. And then once you're working with francium and radium, you need to drop down to the actinides. Okay? And we'll see an example of how to do that here shortly. But first, let's focus in on bromine. So the very first thing to notice about bromine is that its position, right? It is in the 1, 2, 3, 4th row of the periodic table. It's in the P block, and it's in the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5th column of the P block. What that means is that when you put electrons into bromine, the very last thing that you should write is 4P5. It's in the 4th row, the P block, the 5th column of the P block. Okay, so this should be the very last thing that we write. Okay, the other way the periodic table guides us is that if we read it like a book, then it's going to guide us into the order of the orbitals in our configuration. Okay, so here we have 1s. There's two spaces. Helium's over here, but it can also exist here. Okay, so we have 1s, two spaces. If we're reading it like a book, the next place we go is to 2s, and there's two spaces. So it would be 1s2, 2s2. The next place we go is the P block in the second column, or in the second row. So we have 2p, there are six spaces, six columns, so 2p6. We now move down to the third shell where we have the S block. So we have two columns, so 3s2. We move over to 3p, the next thing we write is 3p6. Once we reach the end of the 3p's, we go down to 4, and we have two spots, so 4s2. Now you notice that we hit the D's. Okay, and this is where things get a little bit funny. What you have to remember is that the D orbitals are always one shell below the S orbitals. So if we wrote here 4s2, then we're going to write 3d, and there are 10 columns, so 3d10. So we have moved across these d10s here. Okay, now we're almost to bromine. So to get to bromine, we have to go to 4p, and we have 1, 2, 3, 4, position number 5. So 4p5. And indeed, the last thing that we wrote here was 4p5, just as we predicted based on the position in the periodic table. The last thing you can do to confirm that you did this right is to count electrons. Bromine needs to have 35 electrons. We have 2, 4, 10, 12, 18, 20, 30, and 35. So we did this correctly. Okay? Let's try one more using the periodic table. All right, so let's write the electron configuration for astatine. Astatine is element 85, so it's big, it's really big, and this is going to be a long electron configuration. But using the periodic table as our guide, we note that we are ending in the 2, 3, 4, 5, 6th row. Okay, we're in the P block, and once again, we're in the 5th column. So we're going to need to end with 6P5. So this should be the last thing that we write. So we have 1s2, followed by 2s2, and then 2p6, 3s2, 3p6, 4s2. Remember, now that we move into the D's are always one number below, so 3d10, 4p6, 5s2. We're down to the D's again, so 4d10, 5p6. We now move down to the 6's, 6s2. And now, once we get to 6s2, we've now reached this spot where we talked about before that these f orbitals actually exist. So we need to drop down to our f's. And the thing to remember about f's is they are always two shells below. So 4f, we put in all 14. We then move to our d's, which remember are one shell below. So we have 5d10. And now we're finally to our 6p's, where we can finish up with 6p5. Okay? If you would count all of these electrons up, you would see they add up to 85. Okay? In the next video, I'm going to go ahead and wrap up this idea of electron configurations by showing you a shorthand method that allow us to condense these really, really, really big electron configurations into something much more compact and easily manageable.